Venice, fabled bride of the Adriatic, with the oriental sensuality of the Byzantine, finds place with Gothic aspiration. Venice, the seductress, who has held so many artists in her spell, now has captured another. The Count Luchino Visconti di Madrone. He has the aura of a person accustomed to palaces, as befits an heir of the Duke of Milan, a title dating from the 14th century. His gaze is that of a man who has seen everything worth noticing and of having understood it. He is also the senior of the great triumvirate, Visconti, Fellini, and Antonioni, which has dominated Italian film production for the past 20 years. This morning, in Venice, he will begin another shooting day on his newest film. In it, he combines talents with that of another major artist of our times, one of the great writers of world literature, Thomas Mann. It is to film Mann's masterpiece, Death in Venice, that Visconti rides the canals at 8 a.m. He begins work in a small piazza that serves as a setting for a scene that will appear in the film for only 2 minutes. It will take all day to shoot it. The company has been busy readying the location, preparing for the moment when Visconti will personally approve of every minute detail. They will recreate the hot summer of 1911, described by Thomas Mann in his book. Nothing escapes the director's eyes. Even when it comes to outfitting an old sailor in gear the man might have worn himself that year. Visconti's devotion to the look of the period embraces all the costuming. The fashions of the times are created by his close confidant, Piero Tosi, the designer who puts the ladies in cool linens and tops the costumes with flamboyant hats. The selection of an actor for the role of Tazio was also determined by exhaustive search. Visconti finally decided upon young Bjorn Andresen. At 8:30, Dirk Bogarde begins his daily transformation into the character of Gustav von Aschenbach, the central figure in the story. He was with the director in The Damned, and now he tells how Visconti compares with other directors.
The difference, I think, with Visconti is that he's possibly a little ahead of them all. He's a completely different kind of man to work for. He's an improviser. His attitude to detail is mental. I don't prepare anything. I prepare a track for him to improvise on. I give him the railway line and he puts on the Hornby train, as it were. And then he builds his bridges and his level crossings and his things, but I've given him the track.
I try to make the actors very, very natural, very, very human being, you know, very like men in the life. I don't ask for the actor to play, you know, because this is will be a terrible fault. Also in theater, you know. And if I arrive to put together professional actors and not professional, this is the good mixture, the good cocktail. Yeah.
Bogarde is concerned with finding the real Aschenbach. He searches Mann's book as a source.
Hid behind people, yes. I think one of the big problems about Visconti is that the script is not important to him, beyond the fact that it's an outline on which to superimpose his images. And even when he's reading him, he reads everything. He reads the newspapers, he reads Thomas Mann, he reads every book you can think of, from Goethe to anything. But he still doesn't care about words, and there's nothing, I promise you, nothing you can do about it, because you cannot, one thing you cannot do ever is argue with Visconti.
All right. When the family passed, I go on the water, I see the family, and then I make you...
In the piazza, every stone and window, every color and sound and movement which have been submitted to the master's exacting scrutiny, Aschenbach is about to take one more desperate step in the pursuit of the obsession which holds him in its grip.
Ecco, near that, a little bit more, no, dietro, behind, yes. So, just, yes, all right.
At 9:30 a.m., they are ready to shoot the first take of the day.
Piero Tosi. Dottore.
Grazie, per favore.
Azione.
Thank you.
By noon, they will have shot nearly five takes, the director uncovering nuances all the time. But then this is Visconti's carefully calculated way of getting at the essence of Aschenbach.
Yes. I changed Aschenbach from a writer in a musician because I thought that this was the real idea of Thomas Mann. We have a lot of proof of that. And that he thought about Gustav Mahler. And then I had the idea to make all a film with music of Mahler.
Months ago, Visconti's ideas were developed before the cameras and performers were ready. Meticulously, he sought out the Venice specified by Mann. One translation made was to restore the Hotel des Bains in the Lido. During the winter, when the resort is closed, he took the empty, bare, and wasted old hotel and transformed it with the aid of an army of painters, carpenters, and workmen under the lead of a squad of designers to a realization of its greatest days, its most sumptuous moment of grandeur. Here in the magnificently recreated hotel of 1911, Aschenbach is immersed suddenly in a world of color and sound, and touch and taste, a world rich in idleness and devoted to all the pleasures of haute bourgeoisie. The company returns from lunch, and Dirk Bogarde explains how Visconti concentrates on absolute craftsmanship.
So Visconti is more than a perfectionist. He's a miniaturist. Everything has got to be absolutely perfect. The reflection of a glass dish on a child's face in a scene when I'm having a row with somebody else is equally as important to him as the row. He's extraordinary. It's because of this thing I said to you earlier on, knowing the mind so well and seeing the performance, not through the lens of the camera, which is a very separate thing, seeing it on the floor, but through the eyes of the camera as well.
Each time the scene in the piazza is shot, everything and everyone that will be within the camera's frame is presented for Visconti's eye and approval. It's now late in the afternoon, and this is the ninth take on the same scene. By 6 p.m., the pale light of Venice begins to fade, wrapping the figures in an aura, heightening the feeling that the director has sought all day. His uncompromising demands are being satisfied. On the audience, too, Luchino Visconti makes demands. Whatever his project, it will evoke passionate curiosity and enthusiasm. Death in Venice is sure to be no exception. The day's work over, he will return to his hotel, bathe, rest for a few hours, then have dinner with some friends. Before he finishes reading and retires, it will be 2:30 in the morning. Luchino Visconti makes his own pace and functions best that way.